Yeah, this podcast is about you and your journey in music and how you got to where you are now and forming the Rubens and your new record that just came out like a couple days ago.
Easy.
Right?
Yeah, on Friday. Yeah,
oh, right,
so
on,
still
man.
Fresh.
Very cool. Very cool. So whereabouts did you grow up? Where were you born and raised?
So I was born in I was born in Camden, which is about an hour south of Sydney in Australia.
Okay.
It's kind of like a little kind of country town. It's actually pretty damn big now, but when I was born there, it was a little country town. So Sam, Zach, and I from the band, we're brothers, and we're all from there. The whole band is from there, essentially, but yeah, three of us are brothers.
Wow, that's cool. So obviously you all grew up together, and are you the oldest? Like, who's the oldest brother?
So Sam, who's the lead singer, he's the oldest.
Okay.
And then there's Zach, who plays guitar, and then there's me. Yeah.
Okay.
And then in our family, there's three other younger siblings as well. So
there's
a lot to go around.
Big family.
Yeah, they're not in the band. Yeah, they missed out on the band, but it's a lot of us.
Rad. Well, then, so your older brother, were you like trying to follow in his footsteps in a way, or like how did music come into your life?
Well, we grew up playing music, but it was never like a thing that we did thinking it would be a job. Like, it was just a hobby that we would do. You know, our parents would encourage us to learn an instrument, like you would encourage them to pick up a sport or something. It's just something to do. And so I think we were all just kind of, you know, bedroom musicians, just playing for our own, you know, our own pleasure. And then eventually Sam, who had like a lot of Australians do, he did like a gap year. Once he'd finished high school and went traveling and ended up in London and started playing music over there just by himself, and then came back a few years later when I was finishing high school, and he and Zach were just kind of bored and aimless and didn't have much to do. So just said, hey, do you want to start a band? And me being just, you know, a young kid in high school, I was like, hell yeah, that sounds cool. And so we just decided to do it, and it kicked off from there. Yeah, it wasn't something that was ever planned, or like that was the first time we ever actually played together musically, was when Sam suggested, hey, do you want to start a band? Like, after everything.
Oh, wow. Wow. Yeah. Well, you play keys. So were you always a piano player? Was that the first instrument you learned?
Yeah, first and only, really. And like, I when I was younger, I had to be bribed to take lessons from my mum, and she would give me like a lollipop or something just to go get a lesson from a lady down the street, because I hated it. I just didn't want to do it. Like, it made no sense to me. And then eventually I got more into it, you know, got into music like and pursued it a little more. We're still not, you know, I still can't read music. I still can't do any of that stuff. It's like all that stuff is over my head. It's just like, I like to bash the keyboard, you know?
Sure. At this point, you don't need to learn, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, it's funny. A lot of like, we're not very capable technical musicians. Like, Sam will show me a song idea and he's playing it on guitar, and then I'll be like, oh, so what chord is that, the next one? He'll be like, I don't know.
Try to find it on the piano.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I think honestly, the fact that we're not like technically trained is it's kind of beneficial for us, because if you don't know the ins and outs of what makes up a song, like the technical side of it, you're more capable of, or susceptible to, like just stumbling across things, and that they sound like they're surprises to you. And they're, you know, if someone who can read music and is classically trained would know all those tricks already. And so for us, it's like, we just come across and be like, hey, these chords sound cool together. Who would have known? And
right,
they'd probably
right.
be like, yeah, we would have known, you idiot.
That's awesome. Well, with piano and keyboard, like you said that your mom had to bribe you to go to lessons. When did you end up, you know, just kind of, you know, liking it and playing on your own time?
I think high school, started to get, so I probably only had lessons as a kid when I was like maybe 5 or 6 or something. For a year I might have done it, and I didn't like it. And then high school, I just started to get more into music and wanted to like just, I don't know, participate in it somehow. Like, you listen to your favorite band and you have that urge to be more than just a fan who loves listening to that song. You're like, I want to play that song. How do I do that? You know, I want to get involved. And so that's when I started to get more into it and get involved in the music side of being a fan.
Okay. And did you ever, like, was this your first band? I mean, you said that your brother kind of came back and asked you if you wanted to play with them. Like, was this the first band you ever joined, or were you in stuff like in high school?
In high school, I was in one band with a few mates, and we just kind of, it was kind of like a ragtag thing where we would all just like swap instruments and try and get as many gigs as we could. I think we played like a battle of the band somewhere and lost. Okay. And like all those typical kind of high school gigs, we played at like people's birthday parties and stuff, and we were like, hell yeah, this is sick, we're in a band, we're cool. Sure. So there was actually a point as well where I was in both the high school band and the Rubens, and it was like I felt like at one point I'm gonna have to make a decision here, I don't know which one I want to be in. And then I remember speaking to the high school mates when things started to kick off with the Rubens. I was like, boys, I just don't know if I've got time, like I gotta play this gig, I don't know if I'm gonna have time to do the other stuff. And they were like, it's fine, dude, don't worry about it.
They let you off the hook to leave.
yeah, they're like, we're going to university, man, don't worry, we're not gonna keep on doing this thing. I was like, fair enough.
Yeah, so were you still in high school when the band started?
Yeah, so I was 17 in 2011 when we started the band, and I remember going to like our first couple of gigs, having to get like an X on my hand saying don't serve this kid alcohol because we're playing.
Yeah,
I couldn't drink, and so it was just like, it was a really funny thing to be like, you know, going to, because we're playing a lot of shows around Sydney, and they'd be super, like late night shows playing in like King's Cross, which is like was a pumping area in Sydney. We'd be playing there at like 1:30 in the morning, and then I'd have to go to school the next day and just be like, oh dudes, I'm so tired, why? Oh yeah, I was just at a gig last night, just playing a gig with my band. It's nothing major.
No big deal.
Yeah, a lot of bratty humble bragging, I think, on my part.
That's funny. That's awesome. Well, when you put the first record out, were you still in high school, or were you guys out of high school?
Just out of high school. So that first year, I was finishing high school, and then 2012 was when we put out the first record. So I finished high school late 2011. And then early 2012, we went over to New York to record the first record.
Wow. Okay. And so Lay It Down, wasn't that out though prior, or was that something that you guys put out or recorded in Sydney?
Yeah. So we did a bunch of demos in Sydney, just literally, you know, on Logic on our laptops, and had these tracks and started putting them out on Unearthed, which is a website, an Australian website, that's a part of Triple J, which is a radio station. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of young bands, when you're starting out, everyone puts their music on Unearthed, hoping that people are going to hear it and it'll get played on the radio. So that's what we did with Lay It Down and a couple of other tracks. We put them up there, and they started to get some attention and some love. And so they got put out on radio. And that was when we started to get a little bit of buzz, and we pulled back because we had all these songs and we started putting them out, and we thought, mm-hmm. we got to sit on this material and make an album out of it. And that was what we took over to New York to record the actual record.
Wow. Okay. So with that, with My Gun, that was the second single, and that one won, you know, pretty much, you know, a Grammy award, right? A video music award and like all these other big things. Was that something that you had recorded in New York, or was that a song that you had out prior?
That's one we had prior, but then the album version is different to what people initially heard. So like we had that kind of thing where we started to blow up a bit off these shitty bedroom demos that we'd done. Mm-hmm. And so it's like we almost wanted to like pull them back before people got too attached to those versions, because we're like, oh, don't love this version, guys. We're going to go over and to a proper studio and make a real version. And
sure.
You're going to love that even more. But we like, I remember the feeling of like coming back from New York with the album versions and playing shows. I remember like some like early fans coming up to us and being like, we don't like this new album version, we love the shitty original bedroom.
The
demo version. I'm like, I understand, you know, that's like the first version you hear is the one that you're gonna love, kind of thing.
Sure.
But it was a funny thing where it's like, yeah, things started to kick off quicker than we were anticipating, and so we had to like kind of catch the tail of it.
Mm-hmm. With that first single and getting it on, you know, the radio and stuff, was that kind of a, I mean, I imagine that's a huge moment for you guys, like hearing your song on the radio for the first time. Like, do you remember where you were when that happened?
Yeah, I do. I remember I was at a friend's, I think of just a friend's 18th birthday party. And I think it was some stupid dress up theme. So I was dressed in ridiculous clothes. I don't even know what I was. I might've been like a Great Gatsby themed birthday party. So I looked ridiculous. And then I got a text on my phone from Sam saying, just got word we're about to be played on the radio. So I ran out of the party to my car and then hopped in the car and turned on the radio. And I probably caught like the back half of it or something, but I was so excited.
That's so rad. Were you in high school at that point too, or you had just finished?
Yeah, I was in high school. So it was
that was probably a big subtle brag moment at school too, right? Yeah, you know, we're on the radio.
I remember a friend of mine was like saying, oh, like I really love Lay It Down. Like Sam's voice, it sounds so good in it. And I was like, oh yeah, he does sound really good on it. Like I sing on it as well. And she's like, yeah, but Sam's voice sounds really good on it. I'm like, but I sing it on it as well. You know, like I'm trying to get some kind of credit.
That's funny. Well, then how did you guys get out to New York? Was that like done through, did you meet a manager off of the success of those first couple songs to get you out there? Or is it, you already had a plan to go record the record in New York?
It's a pretty crazy happenstance moment where we had, after we'd done a bunch of demos, we had met up with a guy from our hometown as well called Dean Tuza, who's an engineer producer. And he was like super into our demos. And so our whole plan was, let's record this album with Dean early stages when we were just like writing songs, let's record them with Dean in his home studio. And, you know, we'd planned to do that. And meanwhile, he'd gone over to do the like mix with the master's seminar. I think it was in France. And he like with like Michael Brower, they do like seminars and with a bunch of like young engineers and stuff. Mm-hmm. And he met David Kahn, who was there, who was also on the seminar. Wow. And he showed David Kahn, who's like a New York producer. Mm-hmm. He showed him My Gun and Lay It Down, I think. And David liked it. His ears pricked up and he was like, oh, what's this? This is really cool. And Dean explained to him who we were and that we were starting out and were keen on doing a record. And I think David, he said kind of off the cuff, you know, yeah, I'd love to work with these guys. And I think Dean and also us, we took that when we got word of it, we took that as, yeah, he wants to work with us. Let's do it. Cause we were just young and green and naive.
Sure.
And so I think like talk started to happen between us and David, and we didn't actually have a label at the time. And our mate was managing us. So it was like, we were just kind of like completely green and new to this. But I think we took everything that David said, his enthusiasm, at face value. And so pretty soon Sam and Dean were on a plane to New York and then showed up at David's studio. And he was like, we found out after the fact, he was just like taken aback, like, oh, these Australians have turned up at my studio. You want to make a record? Oh, okay, so let's do it. And so like he allotted this time for us to work in his studio, and the rest of us flew over and we spent like something like 3 months there and hashed out the album. And this was before we had a record deal or anything. Like we borrowed money for plane tickets to get over there from our parents because we were just, you know, working in pizza shops and stuff. We had no cash.
Sure.
We got over there and we were living on like $10 a day, just eating, you know, $1.25 slices of pizza and stuff. It was mad. And I think while we were over there, we were getting a lot of attention from record labels. And that's when we started to get that type of support for the record. Because from the get-go, David, he straight up said, you know, I'll front the bill for this. I really want to make this record with you guys. Let's just make it, get it done. And then when the deal happens, the deal happens kind of thing. So yeah, it was a huge co-sign by him for him to just be like, to back us that way.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I mean, wow. Yeah. He obviously saw something or he wouldn't have wasted his time and, you know, to put out the record before there was any like support for it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. Wow. I think it was we're very lucky in that he was super, super generous and excited by our music. And we were super, super naive to think that you know, we could go over and do it. Like, I think when you're young, you just take those risks because you're just dumb. You're just stupid, you know, you
Right.
don't
Yeah. You
understand
don't know the
that you could.
consequences of it.
Yeah, exactly. It's like we're all still like living at our, in our parents' house, not paying rent. It's like we don't know the risk we're taking, but you know,
Sure.
it all panned out, which is very lucky.
Wow. Okay. So once you get back with the album, were you, I mean, the buzz, I'm sure, was still there, right, with the band. And now you get back, and then do you give the Triple J the album versions of these songs, or did you just wait on them to do the next record?
Yeah, well, like no, so I think luckily enough, we were still getting discovered by a lot of people by the time we got that record done, and so a lot of people hadn't heard those songs, and it was just kind of everything kicked off when we got back. We went got straight into touring, and then the album came out, I think later in the year, 2012, and yeah, we just got a lot of love and started the whole career musician kind of cycle where you know you make a record, you tour that record, you know at the end of 2 years of touring you go back and you make the next record if you've got the material and stuff. And so we kind of had to learn on our feet what that career would look like. But yeah, we were just so happy to be doing it because we hadn't even been a band for very long. We understood how lucky that trajectory was.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, to have that, you know, kind of buzz off of a couple songs that you guys had put out, especially you said that you recorded them in like your bedroom, you know, and
Yeah.
to have that reaction, obviously there was something there. Why'd you guys sign with Ivy League Records? Was that they just gave you the best deal, or how did that conversation start?
Well, we had lots of meetings with different labels, and it really came down to like the people at the record were just we just clicked with them. And we're still so close with them now. Like we've been with them for every record. Yeah, they're all just like really, really good people. We've had them over for like family Christmases before, just because I don't know. I think the fact that like we're all from, all the band members are from a small kind of country town. We're not we didn't grow up thinking that this would be we would be in the entertainment business. We're all pretty, I think like we're not, you know, we're not we don't expect anything from this industry. We're just happy to be here and we love having a good time. So the fact that we all keep each other pretty grounded means that the people that we surround ourselves with, including the label, we want them to be people that we gel with. So I think we're very lucky to be, and same with management and everyone. It's like we're just very lucky to have a good group of people around us.
That's amazing. Yeah. And then that first record, I mean, goes platinum. That must have been a massive moment for you guys.
Crazy, crazy. It's nuts. Especially like even then, you know, people, it wasn't quite streaming quite. Hadn't kicked off just yet, but it was, you know, CD, no one's buying CDs back then and records and things. So to get that type of recognition, we were, yeah, blown away.
And then with the second record, Hoops, was that like when you put that album out, were you thinking like, okay, you know, that the self-titled album did awesome. Like, how are we going to follow that? Or was that not even a thought in your head at the time?
I think it was like an ebb and flow. Like we had so much fun writing and recording, and getting ready for the second record that we managed to trick ourselves into not freaking out, I think. Just because yeah, I think like everyone would say to us going into it, like, ooh, the tough sophomore record, the second record, you know, this is where it's make or break. And what we actually did was we rented a beach house an hour south of Sydney on the coast in New South Wales, where we stayed there for 6 months and we just spent the whole time writing music, recording music, having barbecues, swimming at the beach. And so we just distracted ourselves with a nice, happy environment. And I think, yeah, made sure that we didn't, you know, we didn't succumb to that kind of pressure, which is very lucky.
Okay. So you toured that first record for a while. Were you still in just Australia, or were you branching out like worldwide more?
We did a few US tours. We toured with Group Love.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was on it. That was one of the most fun tours we did. We got to see obviously a lot of America that we hadn't seen before because we're jumping on a tour with them and they're amazing. And they were doing a cool thing where in each city they would do a full band kind of like full production live show, and then the next night they would do an acoustic stripped back performance. So
Oh,
it was really
wow.
cool. Yeah, it was an awesome thing to see how like different ways that you could put on a live show for people. And we were so green and young, like it was nice to see like pros like them, how they do it. And then also did some tours like in Europe and stuff as well. So it was a bit of a whirlwind for some like young kids who had barely flown anywhere before, you know?
Sure. Wow. Was that like their acoustic thing? Was that kind of what led you to do? I want to talk to you about the MTV Unplugged thing in a minute, but that must
All
have
right.
was that thought process in your head when you went into the MTV Unplugged, or was that not even a thing in that at the time?
I think being forced to do an acoustic live show helps with anything you do, where it's like even with songwriting, because it forces you to look at a song and what makes a song good, and you have to like filter it down to its bare elements, you know, the bare bones of what the song is. And so it's a good way to analyze your own songwriting and also your own live show, and make sure that you do have the chops to still deliver whatever the essence of that song is to the audience. So yeah, it's something we have to keep on. You do have to keep a practice at it, you know. And same with, you know, when MTV Unplugged came around, that's a lot of pressure because, you know, there's so much, there's yeah, it's such a you're very lucky to get that offer to do an MTV Unplugged show. So it's like you've got to really be prepped and ready
Ready for it, yeah.
yeah, and not shitting your pants because it's scary, you know. You want
Oh,
to
I
put out
can.
your best foot forward, and that was very
Right.
special though. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Well, back to Hoops real quick. Once you guys, with the success of the first record and you put out that album and it's does awesome as well, like, were the tours getting bigger at that point? Were you headlining bigger tours? Like, what was the next step up for you guys with that album?
So things started to get bigger for us, especially in 2015 or 2016, early 2016, when they do a thing in Australia on Triple J, the radio station, called the Hottest 100, where it's they do a countdown, everyone votes, and they do a countdown of everyone's favorite songs of the year. And Hoops, the title track off that record, won that year. So it took out the top
Wow.
spot, which was something we never expected to happen. Yeah, it's a massive thing in Australia. It's a huge poll. But that was for us, like we had booked a tour at that time, and then the Hottest 100 announcement happened, and so it was a real tangible you know, impact, where it's like our booking agent called us and was like, all right, we're going to double the size of these rooms now because of the Hottest 100. And we were just like blown away, like, are you sure? Like, are we going to be able to sell out these rooms? You know, are you sure? And
Right.
they're like, no, this is a tangible, this is a big thing, this has a big impact. And we were just like, wow, very lucky to be able to progress like that so quickly.
Sure. Wow. What was that like getting that, knowing that you guys had won that? Like being top spy, that's so
It's
massive.
probably the best day of our lives.
Really?
Yeah, dude. And like, two of the people in the band are married, and I'm sure they'll say that it was better than their wedding day. It's a really big thing here. It's a really big thing here. Like growing up in Australia, everyone listens to Triple J. It's a youth-centered radio station. And so the Hottest 100, when it comes around every year, it's a big deal. You have a big party on that day, and you all listen to the countdown. So, you know, to be listening to it and then knowing that there's a chance that you might get a number one spot, is just knowing there's a chance is crazy enough. And then getting number one is just, yeah, it was a very cool thing, especially because it is, you know, listener voted. So it is people saying, hey, this is a song that really connected with me. I want to vote for it. That's a cool thing.
Wow. And that is that the one that happened? Is that on like Australia Day or whatever? Is that the thing that happens then, or is that something different?
Yeah, well, it used to be on Australia Day, and now it's moved because there is a lot of controversy about the date of Australia Day, because
Oh.
it is the day that, yeah, white people invaded and colonized. And so
Ah,
Triple J did
gotcha.
the right thing and said, hey, we're not going to put a celebration on this day. We'll move Hottest 100 to another day where
Okay.
everyone can be happy and celebrate. So it is a good move on their part, yeah.
But it's still like a big, it's, I mean, it sounds like it's a huge thing. Like everybody, they're partying thing. And like, yeah, trying to count down the songs. Like what was, do you remember the song that was, is it only Australian bands or is it all over the
No. Band? No. So the funny thing is we, in number two spot was Kendrick Lamar with King Kunta, which is, it's hilarious because, you know, we know that we're not better than Kendrick Lamar. It's fine. But the fact that, yeah, when we're listening to the countdown, yeah, it's so funny. All it would take would be, you know, in the lead up, if Kendrick had heard that there was some listener poll in Australia and all he had to do was send out a tweet or something and say, hey, vote for me. We know that we'd be done for. But the fact that he didn't know about it, sweet, we'll take that number one spot.
That's so cool. That is it usually a Australian artist that wins or not too often?
It's probably 50-50. I think this year Glass Animals won.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. It goes back and forth. I think like Macklemore won one year. So yeah. It's international, but to be honest, us Aussies do get an extra leg up because there's a lot of pride in trying to get an Aussie song to the number one spot.
That's so cool. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Do they give you like a big award for winning that, or is it just on the air and they go, okay, you guys won?
Yeah, you just get the kudos, the pat on the back, really. Yeah.
But that's so.
But you know, it is because it is such a big thing here. It's special enough.
Yeah, of course. I mean, like you said, they doubled the rooms on your tour because of that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's massive, obviously.
Yeah, wow. Very, very glad. Very lucky.
That's so cool. Well, with the next record that you guys put out, what would you say, Lola Rue, what would you say like the highlight or like a highlight of that album was, or like the big moment for you guys? What was the next, you know, like I said, next level up from that previous record?
For us, it was a cool departure for the fact that the first two records we recorded in New York with David Kahn. And for this one,
he did the second album too. Okay.
He did the second record too. Yeah. So we went back and did it in the same studio. And then for the third record, we realized we had the opportunity to do it here in Australia because Will, who plays bass, he has a studio in our hometown in a big old like World War II communications bunker. It's like this big concrete long tunnel. Yeah, it's crazy. If you go on our socials, I think there should be some photos buried deep somewhere where you can check it out. It's
scroll
nuts.
Down. That's dope.
Yeah, it's cool. It's really cool. But he's got like his own studio there. That's like, you know, it's excellent quality. Like internationally, it's an excellent studio, but it's in our hometown. And so we had the opportunity to actually do the record there, and we flew out two producers, Wilder and Torbert Schwartz, who are like affiliated with Run the Jewels. They help with a lot of their production. Right. Yeah, we met them a few years ago on a tour in Australia because they were touring with LP, and we just kind of like hung out with them a lot and kind of became friends. And then when it came to recording the third record, Lola Rue, we were considering like, all right, who could, if we're going to do the recording here in the studio, we're going to need to bring in some kind of producer to help us tie the thing together and to run the show. And so we thought of them, and then they were totally down. We sent them some demos and they liked them. And then we flew them out for like a month or two and just spent time in Camden, in our hometown in Australia, with these two New York locals, sampling the delights of Vegemite and listening to Australian birds during the day and stuff. It was like an amazing experience just to hang out with them and make music.
That's so cool. That's so rad. And that's the record that you were able to tour. I saw you toured with Pink on that tour.
Yeah, that's the
one. My gosh.
Yeah,
what was that like?
She came out. Dude, it was nuts. It was crazy. Like we've toured with supported big artists before. Like we supported the Black Keys and Bruce Springsteen, but those shows were only for a couple. This tour was 40 something shows in only in Australia and New Zealand. Like that's how big her market is here. She could tour it perpetually. I think it's nuts. So we had to learn how to, you know, function in an arena space night after night after night, and learn how to like connect with people way up the back of the room and stuff. Like it was a bit of a whirlwind. It was weird to be in that space where it is like she tours with her own little town, almost like her own little village. Like there's catering and there's there's personal trainers, not for us because we didn't have to do any gymnastic. It's all for, you know, her and her crew and stuff. But it is just like this city of people that roll into each town or city or whatever, and then pack up and move out. So it was like, it was very eye opening to see that side of like the entertainment industry.
Yeah, like that level of production.
Yeah, it's nuts. It's nuts. Like they are super committed to, you know, their show. Like for us, a band of idiots who don't even know how to play their instruments properly, and just, you know, we just drink beers on stage every night and get through the songs. And these guys are like professional musicians, only like they've all got like their own trainers and stuff. They're stretching before the show, and we're just like, oh, all right, we should probably take this seriously.
Wow. How did you guys approach that? Those like stadium shows? I mean, that must've been a totally different experience as far as like, okay, now we have to take our, you know, rock show or, you know, our smaller venue show to this gigantic arena, and you have to, you know, go up before Pink with her Acrobats. Like, did you guys take a different approach, or was it the same? We're just going to go out and play.
We planned it for the first show. We're like, all right, so we'll do the show this way. We'll have these moments, and we'll, like, you know, we'll go hard. I think our set was only like 30 minutes, so we didn't have to like keep them for too long. It was just, I had given them the hits. And after the first show we played, we got off stage and we were just like, oh, I don't know if this is going to work. Like we felt like, you know, the audience is so far away. Even the people in the front row, they're so far away. How are we connecting with them, let alone people up the back? And we had a big talk with everyone, with like our management and everyone, because we were like, if we don't start to connect with this audience, we're probably going to get kicked off this tour or something. Because it wasn't like terrible, but it was like, you know, you want to get the crowd going for the main act, Pink. You want to get that energy in the room. And so the next night, it was really just down to Sam, our front man. We were just like, all right, Sam, you've got to ham it up. You got to turn it up to 11 to like really, really connect with everyone in the room. And full credit to him, he really, really did turn it up and learn how to like connect with everyone in the audience and jump off the mic and kind of, it sounds almost like you have to turn up the cheesiness, but it's true, because people up the back of the room, especially, you know, they don't know the band. They don't care about you. They're there to see Pink. Mm-hmm. So to connect with them in a meaningful way, you have to really, really turn it up and ham it up. And luckily we didn't get kicked off the tour. We did it in the end.
That's amazing. And then how did the MTV thing happen for you guys, the Unplugged?
Yeah. So they started doing a run with Australian acts, while we were touring that record. So we'd seen a bunch of big Australian acts do it over here, and we honestly just hoping that we would get that email saying, hey, you've got the offer to do MTV, crossing our fingers and toes. And then we got that offer, and like all of a sudden excitement turns to nerves, because it's like, okay, so what do we do?
Right.
There's been a lot of iconic and now that we're doing it, what do we do? And so it was like, there was honestly just an amazing opportunity to then look at our songs and then say, all right, so how could we do these interestingly? How can we strip them back? What can we bring in? So we brought in some string players, which is, you know, I think a lot of musicians' dreams, where it's like when you play in a 5-piece band and you're limited to whatever you guys can play, to bring in outside performers who are professionals and have them on stage and have them elevate the music was really, really cool. And as well, like I remember doing the rehearsal with these string players before the show, and like they'd been given sheet music. We had a mate of ours who's a like pro musician. We had him write off the sheet music for them. Mm-hmm. And we get in the room with them and we run through each song once, and we're like, oh, they're nailing it, like first time every time. Like, and we get to the end of the set and we're like, do you guys like need to go through it again? And they're like, no, we're fine. And we're like, Jesus Christ, these guys are good. Like, we're good too. See you on stage, kind of thing.
So you guys,
crazy to see that level of professionalism.
Wow. Like, it's pretty much just one take, right? Did they have like an audience still and everything? Like, how does that work? Okay.
Yeah. So it's a room full of people sat at tables. I think it's this beautiful venue in Melbourne, in Australia, called, I can't even remember the name of it, something St. Kilda, I think. Oh, the Hotel Esplanade, I think it's called. But it's a beautiful, like, iconic venue. Yeah, like everyone at tables with candles and stuff, and
Oh, cool.
nice and chilled. The funny part is, like, when we walked on stage, you know, it feels like this great, beautiful moment, and there's cameras everywhere, and all right, you know, everyone's excited, don't screw this up. And the first song is a song that I start, and I get there, and like my keyboards aren't working, I'm not getting any power, and so I'm just like, yeah. I think I just said into the mic, "Hey everyone, just a little false start here. Like, I don't have any power on the keyboards, and I'm running around trying to find where it is that's plugged in. It's like we've lost power to half the stage." That eventually gets plugged in, and then we start the set. And I think, like, watching back the MTV, like actual the filmed version, it's like obviously they trimmed all that and it
Oh
looks
yeah,
super
edited it
professional.
out.
Yeah, no mistakes, you know, false starts. It was all beautiful, smooth as hell. It's like, not actually behind the scenes, it was a train wreck in the beginning.
Oh man. That must have been pretty like yeah, terrifying. You're like, did I not turn it on? Like, what's going
Oh,
on? Like, oh
it's
my
also as
gosh.
well, like those moments I think can be a blessing, because especially settings where it's like that's a seated crowd, it's not a raucous pub or whatever, there is this kind of feeling of, oh, this is a bit weird, this is a bit different. And then if you have something like that go kind of wrong, but you wear it as a performer, I think you break that barrier with the audience, and everyone's like, oh, we can relax, this isn't too serious, we don't have to take ourselves too seriously, everyone can just have fun. And then from there it's
Right.
like, you know, yeah,
It's almost like an icebreaker, an accidental icebreaker to the audience. Like,
exactly.
we're humans too. Sorry, hang on. Let's figure out the power here.
Yeah, and people like respect that and relate to that, I think.
That's, yeah, I think that's so cool. Not the cool that it screwed up, but like, you know, just having that,
Yeah.
okay, like, yeah, they're just people. Like, let's all have fun. You know, everybody makes mistakes, or not mistakes, but you know, somebody didn't plug
Yeah.
in some plug or whatever.
Yeah, it's like a show, warts and all. Let's just get through this together.
Right. Wow. So where were you guys at when this whole virus hit and the world shut down?
We were actually putting like the finishing touches on this new record. So we
Oh, okay.
were.
So you had already started it and it was almost done at this point.
Yeah. So we started recording mid-2019, and then in the bunker again at Will's studio.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, but self-producing initially this time. So it was just band members in the studio doing it ourselves, which was really, really cool. And then I think, so maybe March, we were putting the finishing touches on like the last tracks in the studio. And that was when things started to go crazy and lockdowns happened. And it was, honestly, like just as we weren't allowed to be together in the studio because of lockdown, was when we had succeeded in finishing everything we needed to do. So we're like,
Oh,
we got it in under the wire.
right. Wow. That's good. Wow.
Yeah. We're very glad. I think we're also very lucky that the songs weren't written during COVID time, because, you know, they're not tainted by that experience. They're not songs about being in lockdown or whatever. It's just they're unsullied. I think probably a lot of terrible music is going to be written during lockdown.
Yeah. I mean, everyone's getting sick of looking at the same walls, right? I mean, it's been so long
Yeah.
now. It's like almost at a year. Like, it's so crazy.
Yeah.
I don't know
I
how tight
think
the
people.
lockdown is there, but here we're still pretty. I'm in San Diego, but and we're
Yeah.
like, you know, you can't even eat inside yet.
Oh, really? Right. Things are okay here. I'm in Sydney at the moment. Things are good here. Melbourne is in another lockdown at the moment just because they had a few cases. But I think compared to, yeah, like where you are, America and Europe as well, Australia's doing pretty good.
Yeah,
Fairly
you
good.
guys are
We have
doing
our
really
ups and
good.
downs, and yeah, not as
Yeah.
good as New Zealand. I've seen they're doing like festivals and stuff over there. It's like, God damn, I wish we
Really?
were over there.
Oh,
Yeah, they've got it good
wow.
over there,
Wow.
man.
Yeah, I was talking to the somebody in Perth from Psychedelic Porn Crumpets. I'm
Oh,
sure
yeah.
you know that band. Yeah.
Yeah,
So
I don't
they're
know
in
them personally,
Perth.
but I know their music, yeah.
Yeah, I was talking to the singer and he was like, it was no big deal, because but that Perth is pretty far from where you guys are,
Yeah.
correct? I mean, you're like at the opposite end of the country.
Yeah, it's the most isolated city in the world, apparently. Yeah, Sam, the lead singer, he spent a bit of time over there during lockdown because his wife is from over there. So he was over there while I think we were going through a bad lockdown in Sydney, And I remember like speaking to him every now and then and be like, so what's it like over there? And he's like, man, life is normal over here. And I was just
yeah.
like, God damn it.
That's what he was saying. He's like, we had shows and yeah, they were going to the pub. And like the day I talked to him, they had a lockdown for 7 days because I guess somebody left and came back and he was like a postman and he got it. So then he's going to different houses, you know, like dropping mail or whatever. They locked down for 7 days and, but then nothing happened. Like nobody, there's no spike in cases. So they're opening it up. And I was talking to him. It was like noon his time. And he's like, the bars are opening. The pubs are opening up here at 6 p.m. And he's like all excited. Like I'm going to get 9 pints. He kept saying, and I'm like, dude, we haven't been outside for like a year. Don't tell me about going to the pub.
I know. It's bad. I feel like every now and then, like when I'm at the pub and, you know, life is just kind of normal. And then I see, you know, friends overseas where it's just like, you know, we have mates in London and they're in another lockdown and stuff. And I'm just like, especially being in like winter, like just being stuck. Yeah. Yeah. I think we're very lucky. We have to not take it for granted.
Sure. I mean, yeah, you guys are doing something correct over there for sure. If, you know, the cases are down and people are actually out as we're here, we're just still trying to figure it all out. Yeah. But wow. I'm glad that you got that record in. That's crazy. So once the album, I mean, obviously you had to hold it for a bit because you couldn't tour or anything. Like, what was that like? Like in the, you know, having the album done and not being able to, or not really wanting, I guess, to put it out.
It was a bit, it was honestly like not too hard because I think most musicians, we're kind of used to finishing a piece of work and then you always sit on an album for a while once it's done. Mm-hmm. Before putting it out, because that's just kind of the way it works. Like there's so much to set up behind the scenes once the record is done that it can be 6 to 8 months before the album that's mm-hmm. sitting in your Dropbox and you want everyone to hear in the world, but it can be that long before it's actually out in the public. So we were okay. The fact that we had to put it back, you know, it just made sense. It's like we're not gonna be able to tour. I think initially we wanted to put it out in October, but that just couldn't happen, and so we pushed it back. But yeah, it's been nice to have it out now because in Australia, in New South Wales, the past 2 weeks, we've been doing some regional touring where we've done like COVID safe shows. So reduced capacity shows and then seated shows where we've actually been able to play the live music for people. So I'm really glad that we did hold off because if we did in October, we wouldn't have been able to do anything probably. And it would have kind of felt like a soft release, you know?
Yeah. Wow. That's awesome that you guys have been able to do like a little bit of touring and playing out. Like, are they just setting up tables and sticking people like 6 feet apart or something?
It's not, most of them are like, they're seated kind of like theater shows. So So the seats are already there and it's like, they sell it under capacity. So people will be spread out. And everyone has to stay in their seats. Honestly, a lot of the time people are jumping up in their seats and start dancing and security come around and ask them to sit again. And then, you know, in between songs, we have to ask them politely to stay in their seats. And most generally everyone's well behaved. But I understand their pent up energy in having not been to a gig in so long. They're just like, they want to jump out of their seat and have a
right.
But it's like, all right, we're trying not to get sued here. Don't
ruin this for everybody. Right?
Yeah, we don't want to make the news for the wrong reasons. You know, can we just all behave? Yeah, right, but it has been very special to actually, you know, be on a stage and play music again.
That's amazing. I'm glad that that you're able to do that because a lot of artists aren't even able to promote the stuff that they're just putting out. I mean, that's cool that you guys have been able to play a bit.
Yeah, we're so lucky because for a long time, you know, released a lot of music last year, a lot of singles leading up to the record and played no shows. And for most artists, putting a song out, you don't really get a gauge of how well it's doing until you play a live show and you see people like sing it back at you. If they're singing it back to you, they love the song, obviously. Mm-hmm. And so not having that for a long time was difficult. But now it's like we're getting in front of people and we're playing that music and we're seeing it connect with people. So it's a very good feeling.
That's awesome. That's really cool. And with you know, you guys had the record done right under the wire, like you're saying, have you been writing since, or do you have like new material going, or you're just kind of sitting on this record, or not sitting on it, but like finally getting the chance to promote it? So that's kind of the focus.
Yeah, we're always writing, no matter what we're doing. We're always trying to write no matter what we're doing. We don't have, the solid base for whatever is next yet. It's kind of like we always, once a record is out, you start sowing the seeds for whatever is next. But we have spent the last year working with other artists as well, other young artists, doing co-writes with them to try and help them with their like songwriting process, something we're trying to get into now. Like, we've been a band since 2011, so we've been writing songs for a while, and it's like we realize that there's a lot that we've learned that we could help other young artists with. So that's been really fun to just like see artists that, were in that early stage that we were in, when I was 17 and making music and stuff and not really understanding the industry, and help them out along the way has been really cool.
I love that. And to that point, my last question for you is, what advice do you have for aspiring artists?
Well, yeah, I guess it's that. You got to keep on working at your craft. I think right now, obviously, you can't play shows. A lot of the time, the thing I would say would be, play as many live shows as you can, because you just get better and better, and you'll build a fan base, and people will respect you as a performer and stuff. But the thing is, you can't really do that. I'd say just write as much as you can, because the more you write, the more you get that, that nugget of gold, and you just get better at it. It's a muscle, you got to flex it. Bring me the bad words.